Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our Sixth Student Press Initiative book release celebration.
Ernest Hemingway once iterated,
"There is nothing to writing. All you do is sit down at a typewriter and bleed."
Given these words of Hemingway, we sat at our keyboards before a blank screen, expecting to hemorrhage some profound truth. But nothing came, and we were vastly disappointed or frustrated at our inability to write a single word or phrase. We heard the clock ticking, or our phones vibrated, and we cursed Hemingway for his deceit. We were done.
But we were not done reading the staccato rhythm of Hemingway.
The cold rain kept on and killed the spring.
We read the harsh tone of Hawthorne's prose.
What other dungeon is so dark as one's own heart?
We pondered the mood of terror painted by Poe.
Falling, it was rain, but having fallen, it was blood.
Like Thoreau, we found that
truth and roses have thorns about them.
Where are we? We were in the throes of discovering how great authors skillfully draw blood and the reader into their world.
Writing is not opening a wound, the blood gushing and splattering randomly. There's something more to it. Rather, writing is a bloodletting, a slow, visceral dripping. It is a careful crafting of words, drawing readers in to reveal an artery of simple truths. With new understanding, we sat and wrote our truth. With carefully chosen words, we bled on these pages.
Our simple truth is that what you will discover through our stories, truths which we have discovered about ourselves and the world around us. For here, we have opened our veins and skillfully let the droplets of blood flow from our pages.
We are Bleeding Truth.
Our first author reading Mighty Mom, Brianna Peguero.
I woke up with the aroma of rice and pork chops still floating around from last night's dinner. As I started crawling out of bed with the mindset that it was going to be a typical day for a high school freshman, I walked across to the bathroom to go about my daily routine. My house was unusually quiet. I started to brush my teeth when suddenly there was a loud banging on the door. It was so loud that I thought it was the police. I got kind of nervous. My mom is a single parent and I'm one of three children. I'm the youngest and only girl. I have two older brothers, Carlos and Alexis. Not only does my mom struggle with being a single parent, she also battles fibromyalgia. A person with fibromyalgia has long-term body-wide pain. And tenderness in the joints, muscles, tendons, and other soft tissues. It's also been linked to fatigue, sleep problems, headaches, depression, and anxiety. My mom has a lot on her plate. Having to raise three children by herself while living off of disability checks and food stamps is definitely not an easy lifestyle. That morning, I heard a couple of voices coming from our living room. Then I heard footsteps coming towards the bathroom. My mom knocked on the door very faintly with two of her knuckles. She said, "Brianna, hurry up and pack a bag with some clothes in it." I don't know how I started to put two and two together, but suddenly I knew we were getting evicted. I wanted to cry my eyes out right there. But I knew for my mom's sake, I had to stay strong. I went to my room and started to pray. I didn't ask God to save us from eviction, rather to get us through it. I pulled myself together, wiped my tears, packed my bag, and stayed strong for my mom's sake. I walked out to the living room and saw the man that was doing this to us. "You cruel bastard," was all I could think at the moment. I couldn't hold in the tears. I wanted to cry and cry until my body had a drought. I had my bag, but all I really packed was one outfit. I didn't want to believe it was happening to my family. I was about to head to my aunt's house like my mom told me, but I didn't want to go anywhere without her. I remember she made a phone call to a man she'd known for a while she was in her living room, while she was in her room speaking to him. I sat in the living room staring at the man who was about to evict us. I hated him, and I didn't even know him. I heard rumors, and none of them were good. Suddenly, my mom handed her phone to the man. I didn't know what was happening, but then I felt a positive energy enter the room. The manager spoke into my mom's phone and looked shocked. He left without saying a single word to us. I believe it was a sign from God. My mom ripped the eviction notice off of our door. No one said life was going to be easy, but I wish it were for my mother. I want to repay her for her bravery and her hard work. I will strive for success so she doesn't have to worry about anything. I love her with all my heart. I love you, Mom.
Thank you, Brianna. Our next author reading, The Monster, Angela Garcia.
Thank you. I didn't really know where I was going or why I was going there, but I went. I went alone. I arrived in Amsterdam, New York at 5 in the evening. I stepped off the bus and an icy chill ran down my cheek. I saw her in the distance. She looked happy. I took a long, deep breath and walked toward her. I didn't care about the past. I was focused on seeing my siblings. I drowned everything out except my feet hitting the pavement. I never had a mother. I had a monster. A monster had given birth to me. I remember lying on my side, hearing my parents fight. I got used to drowning them out. I curled up and felt like I could cry. I was 7 years old. I remember walking to the kitchen when someone grabbed my neck before I could grab anything. I started to squirm, to scream, and then I got slapped. Blood gushed from my mouth. I was slammed against the wall. I got up and ran away. I curled up next to a pile of dirty, unwashed clothing. Only when I saw the large bottle of liquor and a white bag did I realize that my mother was drunk and high. The scent of marijuana clung in the air. She came to check on me. The emptiness in her eyes made it difficult to look at her. She beat me until I couldn't breathe. When she was finished, I was numb. I couldn't feel my arms or legs, and I couldn't move. I was left with a broken arm and elbow, 7 stitches, and in my grandmother's custody. When I was around 8, I saw my siblings getting taken away. It was the hardest thing for me. There were no goodbyes or hugs. Just me and the black car with tinted windows that took them away. I remember how the pavement under my shoes burned through my feet up to my face. Hot tears flowed from my eyes. It was the hottest July of my life. We arrived at my mom's beat up 3-bedroom apartment. My brothers and sisters didn't even know who I was. And I put the bag that I had in my sister's room. When I did, I heard the voice I had been dying to hear. Angela, is that you? It's Angie. My brother Christian ran to me. Angie, are you staying? Will you live with us? Before I could answer, my mom had ruined the moment. Yeah, I'm going to hook up my apartment. And you see this living room? It's going to be renovated and look amazing. She repeated herself bragging. Sounds like a plan, I said with little emotion. I looked at Christian. He got so big. He was talking to me. He was normal, as if he grew out of his autism. I met Jaden Avery for the first time, and he was 8 months old. My heart broke. I was missing out on their lives. I realized that I really did miss them. For the past few years, I avoided them. I didn't visit or call to check in. I felt like everything was my fault. Everyone was supposed to be happy. I was supposed to be happy. Instead, I was watery-eyed and red-faced, muffling my cries. That night, I fell asleep crying. I ended up staying for 2 weeks. My last day, I woke up to my sister screaming, "Mommy, Angie's face is blue." My mom looked at me. I was choking. Whether it was my emotions or my asthma, I really couldn't tell. I gasped for air. 30 minutes later, I finally said, "I got myself too worked up." "What do you mean worked up?" my mom asked. I looked at her. "When I get too excited, I get asthma attacks in my sleep." I sat up with my feet on the floor. She looked puzzled. "When you slam me against that wall and beat me senseless, you caused health problems, especially with my breathing." She sucked her teeth at me. "You didn't have it bad." I stood up and took a few deep breaths. "Don't act like you don't remember. Don't act like you didn't try to kill me or pretend like I wasn't there. Don't act innocent." I got emotional, but I went on. I had to. "I try to be a good daughter and make you proud. I try to be here for you, but you don't call me. You don't tell me you're proud of me." I went on, and I had finally found my voice. "I don't want you in my life. I don't care about you anymore." I felt a slap across my face. This time I didn't curl up in a ball. "You're not my mother, you're a monster." I grabbed my bag and left. It's been 2 months since we've spoken, and her last words to me were, "You're dead to me." In confronting her, I finally realized that her actions were not my doing. Her actions were not my fault. I realized I didn't need her, and I never did.
Thank you, Angela. Our next author reading the lesson, Dominique Rotundi.
It was a sunny Sunday morning. I woke up as if I was a child on Christmas morning. I couldn't shake off the excitement I had over getting the chance to drive for the first time. I always envisioned myself being a great driver, and the fact that my grandfather was going to teach me made it even better. I ate, got dressed, brushed my teeth as fast as I could. I didn't even wait for the elevator. I ran down the stairs to meet my grandfather in the parking lot. He was outside leaning against his car. He had the same jean jacket he probably had for 30 years with a pair of worn-out jeans, and he was smoking a cigarette. I made my usual comment to him. "Hey, I thought you were supposed to quit." "Yeah, Dom, tomorrow I will." "You've been saying that for the past week." "Oh, shut up." He smiled and waved his arms, gesturing me to go away. He then laughed about it for a few seconds, and I walked towards the car with my grandfather, following slowly behind me. I made my way to the driver's seat and sat down. Then I heard a tapping on the window. I rolled down the window and saw my grandfather standing there with a smirk on his face. "Huh, you think you're gonna start driving right away?" I squinted back at him, confused. "Well, that's what I thought, considering you said you'll teach me how to drive." "We haven't gotten that far yet," he responded sternly as he gestured me to sit in the passenger seat. I let out a sigh, rolled my eyes, and made my way to the passenger seat. He was going over every little detail about the car. He even tested me to see if I was actually paying attention. After 20 minutes of reviewing the gears, he actually pulled out of the spot. He then starts to test me on all the driving laws. I mean, I should have expected this, considering he was a retired police officer. He would get so angry if I didn't know the most insignificant law about driving. After watching him drive for about an hour, he finally gave me a chance. The only catch was, I was only allowed to drive in the parking lot. I made my first turn and he let out a scream and jerked back the emergency brake. "Are you crazy?" he shouted at me, trying to catch his breath. "What happened?" I screamed back. "You were way too close to the parked car," he responded, trying to calm his voice. I let out a sigh. After 20 minutes of him screaming, constantly pressing the emergency brake, and giving me a lecture over every single thing I did, he finally told me to pull over and put the car in park. He got out of the car with a smile and said, "Same time next week," and walked into the apartment building. I rolled my eyes and laughed and followed behind him. A few months later, it was time for me to take my road test. My grandfather drove me to the DMV on that early Monday morning. I slept most of the way there, and when I was actually awake, my grandfather was constantly texting me to make sure I knew everything I had to know. When we arrived at the DMV, my grandfather gave me a hug and wished me luck. He got out of the car to switch seats with me and to let the instructor in the passenger seat. 30 minutes later, I drove up to the curb where my grandfather was patiently waiting for me. There he was waiting for me. Just like he always been there, whether it was me finally learning to ride a bike, losing my first tooth, or getting my first ace in volleyball, he was always there. I put the car in park and got out. I had a big smile on my face as I held up my driver's license. He smiled back at me and said, "I'm so proud of you." He put his arm around me and gave me a hug. I handed him the keys and he threw them back. "You drive home." On the way home, I realized my grandfather will always be there for me for the big moments in my life, regardless of how old I get. Thank you, Dominique. Our next reader is Aisha Centeno with her story of fear.
It was a nice day, a Saturday or Sunday morning. I knew from the bright sky that it was going to be a good day. I was about 9 or 10 at that time, and I was much brighter than I am now. I was happy. I was sitting in the dining room daydreaming when suddenly my dad started to panic. He found bruises on my brother's butt. He ran into the living room shouting, "I'm going to take photos of this and report it." I tried to tell him that the bruises were from me teaching my brother how to ride a bike, but he wouldn't listen. At school the following day, I was pulled out of class. I followed my principal to a private room. The social worker's face was still in focus, like she was trying to control herself. Her eyes told it all. They were glistening, and they were sad. Her shoulders were tense, and her fingers shook while she wrote everything I told her. Every few seconds, she would look at me and try to smile. After school, my dad took us to a building. I remember walking up to the front of it. The numbers 450 were outlined in bold. I walked in and saw my mother, stepfather, stepbrothers, and stepsister. I knew it couldn't be any good if they were all there. My stepfather was slouched in the chair playing a video game on his phone. His eyes were watery. I looked at his face and saw fear. An undercover police officer called us in one by one to talk. She put her gun and badge on the little round table and introduced herself. My skin began to burn and my arms itched as my throat closed in on me, making it hard for me to breathe or talk. My eyes were giving up on me as well. I couldn't see the officer in front of me. Everything was blurry. I could feel cold tears running down my cheek. She asked personal questions that I felt uncomfortable answering, but I answered honestly. Growing up, I was always told that the truth would set you free. Later, I realized that this was a lie. The truth got us in trouble. And maybe if I weren't so honest, they wouldn't have seen my mom as a bad guy. I was so naive that I didn't see any of it coming. Days passed without seeing my mom, and I finally realized that I had lost her to typhus. We moved in with my father, but I had to live upstairs with my aunt. She was married and had a clear criminal background. It was uncomfortable. I had to adjust living with the new family while being separated from my brothers and my mother. My aunt transferred me to my childhood school, PS23. A lot of people remembered me, but I didn't care. After school, I spent my days in my grandma's living room because I felt safe there. I didn't like being upstairs. I became angry at the world. Some days I went straight to my grandmother's house, locked myself in her little computer room, and just cried for hours. My family called for me, but couldn't find me. I would hear them saying things in the kitchen about my mother. Talking about my mom was a sensitive topic for me. I didn't want to hear it unless it was good. I never understood how they can say wonderful things about her to my face, but when I wasn't there, say terrible things. I never got used to living upstairs. I didn't feel safe or at home. I didn't feel safe in school. I got bullied a lot. Kids thought I was a nerd. I was fat and shy. Some tried to be my friend, but I always thought that they were out to hurt me. After a while, I didn't know how to hold in my anger. I fought everyone. The vice principal's office became my best friend. Anger didn't help, neither did the fighting. All I wanted was my mother back. Finally, months later, I got to see her. When she walked in, I wanted to cry, but I had already used all my tears from crying myself to sleep. I ran into her arms. She was crying. My little brother bawled his eyes out. This time, the tears were tears of happiness. After several dreadful months of being apart, we were finally a family again. It was one of the best days of my life. We took photos, laughed, and cried. I was happy in that moment. I was genuinely happy.
Thank you, Aisha. Next reading, loss number two, William Ethier III.
Lost, confused, abandoned. When I was still a baby, only learning to walk without my father's steady hands on my shoulders, I knew that something was wrong. Something was missing. I never really knew my biological mother, but the hugs, the kisses, the faintest memory of a smile were seared into my brain. When my father retired from the Army, we moved from Hawaii to Virginia to a two-story house, in a massive backyard and an ugly crabapple tree in the front. I still remember the address, 980 Colleen Drive. My brother and I would play catch or soccer with the other kids in the cul-de-sac. My dad got remarried. I had a stepbrother and two stepbrothers, stepmother and two stepbrothers. There was always something to do, some mischief to get into. I loved my stepmother and she loved me. She was in my life since I was a baby, so I grew up calling her mom. But she was bipolar and didn't always take her medication, and she would go through phases. I remember waking up one day, and the sun streaking through the window cast me in a glowing warm circle. If I had known that once I rolled out of the circle, the warmth would go away, then I would have stayed there. That afternoon, my father took me and my brother food shopping. I asked if mom was coming, and for the first time in my life, my father looked at me with something other than love in his eyes. I walked out the door with my little brother literally on my heels. I leaned back in the car seat and looked out the window and saw our dogs running back and forth. The glass door opened and my father walked out, keys in hand. My stepmother stood in the doorframe watching him walk towards the car. I waved at her. I remember the ride to the grocery store, the way my father was acting, the way his shoulders would tense up out of the blow. When we got to the store, he grabbed my little brother's hand and the three of us walked in. I knew something was wrong. He was acting strange, stopping and staring at products on the shelf like he was reading his obituary. He also didn't take out any of the extra snacks my brother and I put in the cart. When we got in line to pay, I looked at my father and felt unknown feelings that I couldn't place blossom deep down in my stomach. I finally asked if something was wrong. He looked me in the eyes and reassured me that everything was fine. But I spent hours looking in my father's eyes. I knew there was something swimming behind the calm demeanor. When we got back to the house, my father told us to stay in the car. I complained and begged to carry the bags of the cans. I wanted to get bigger muscles like my father. He told me not. My brother and I sat in the back of the car watching him go back and forth from the trunk to the house. As he grabbed the last of the groceries, I opened the door and asked to go inside. He put the grocery bags down and nodded his head. I helped my brother out of the car and together we ran for the house. My father stepped in front of us. I looked at him, but I didn't see my father. I saw a man who was scared of a secret that was eating away at him. My superhero had a weakness. I walked around him into an empty house. A cold feeling washed over me as the truth hit me like a tidal wave. She was gone. Her perfume hung in the air, but she was gone. I crumbled to the floor. Only later when I learned that my father called my name, eventually came up and wrapped me in a rare hug and carried me to my room. Sometimes to this day, I wonder how she's doing. Part of me hates her for what she did. She never even said goodbye. She didn't give me one last hug or kiss. She didn't say I love you one last time. Part of me misses her. Part of me wonders how I picked up all the pieces and moved on.
will.
Our next reader is Eliza Brown with Happy to Help.
When I walked in, opening the door in the room, I could see a group of men were playing card games and watching news. The room was quiet, except for the voice of Bill Ritter coming from the television. The place smelled like the dirty clothes, and smell made me feel very little nervous. I went into the kitchen. I went to meet where I met the cook. I told her that I was there happy to help. She winked. Great. We could use the help. She told me every day I will have to wrap up the forks and knives with napkins. I could also help out by washing clothes for the homeless people. I was happy to help. How did I get here? Well, I heard the announcement in school, come from to the student center to sign up to the homeless shelter. And I thought about all the homeless people just sitting and standing around on Washington Street. I felt very badly for them. Then they had to sleep on the ground asking people for money to eat or they might starve. They are hungry and thirsty and they have nothing to eat. By volunteering at the homeless shelter, I could help them. This would be an easy way to help each other. After school, I went to the student center and signed up. So there I was at the homeless shelter, helping another way I could. I ran to Fury's to pick up the bread that for the leftovers. I would bring the bread back to the homeless shelter and cut it up. And I used it for the dinner. After I set out the wraps, forks, and spoons, and I helped serve the dinner, chicken, pasta, salad, and drinking water, men and women and a little child come to the table and act hungry. I looked at their faces, smiling at each other, their eyes open and happy to be at the table with one another. After dinner, we all cleaned up, and some of the homeless helped to wash the dishes. It makes them feel better if they could help each other. We flipped the tables up and put them behind the wall. People would be sleeping there, so we took down the mattresses and made up the beds with blankets and pillows. Some of the guys went out for a smoke break and some took showers, put on the nice clean clothes, and I washed. The room smelled better, then the light went out. I walked home fast because it was getting late. When I got home, my dad had ready dinner for me. He is a good cook and his macaroni and cheese is delicious. After dinner, I cleaned up because that is my responsibility. I slept into my nice, comfortable bed and I thought how lucky I am. I have a positively home and family that who loves me. How grateful I am. I am happy to help.
Thank you, Eliza. Next author reading, My Guardian Angel, Justine Mills.
April 11, 2006 is the day my life changed. As I was getting ready for school, my dad received a phone call. He went into the bedroom and closed the door. He didn't say a word to us and stormed out of the house. I knew that something was wrong. Jay, you aren't going to school today, my mom said. I was happy missing school, but I was also worried. I was afraid. My hands got sweaty and my body got the chills. The last thing on a six-year-old's mind is losing someone extremely close to them. My mom got ready while I finished getting dressed. We left the house and started to drive to New York. I didn't dare ask any questions because I could see in my parents' faces that something was extremely wrong. My dad was quiet the entire car ride, and it just made me more nervous. We were driving somewhere I didn't recognize. We finally pulled into a parking lot. I looked at the building. It said hospital. We walked in, and the first thing I saw was my aunt. She was crying. My dad's sister is one strong lady. Seeing her cry didn't seem right. My stomach turned. Mom, what is going on? My voice was soft. I wanted to cry. Jay, Grandma's very sick, she said with tears in her eyes. The doctors are pretty sure that she won't be with us much longer. My mom's voice cracked. I walked over to my aunt and hugged her. Justine, Grandma wants to see you. I was filled with mixed emotions. I wasn't sure how she was going to look. I was uncomfortable seeing my grandmother lying in bed suffering, but I needed to see her one last time. We walked into the room and my heart dropped. My grandmother was hooked up to so many machines. She was suffering. Memories ran through my mind. My grandmother was the first person to let me wear heels. I was four and loved to dress up like a princess and walk around her house in heels. I was my grandmother's princess. I would always be her princess. I grew up seeing her in and out of the hospital, but I knew it was her time to go. My aunt pulled up a chair. I sat next to my grandmother and held her hand. No words were exchanged. We sat in silence. I noticed my grandmother was struggling to breathe. She took one last deep breath, and the machine went off. It was loud and made a beeping sound. I sat in complete shock. I witnessed my grandmother take her last breath. I hugged my aunt. She broke down like there was no tomorrow. My parents came in the room and stood in silence. We lost the most important female in our lives. There were no words to be shared. That day is a nightmare in the back of my mind. I feel empty without my grandmother. It hurts knowing that she won't be there for my high school graduation, college graduation, or wedding. But I know that she is looking down on me. I will always have her in my heart. I will make her proud. Everything I accomplish will be for her, my guardian angel.
Thank you, Justine. Our next author reading my story, Natasha Rivera.
Natasha, you know you shouldn't be ashamed of what happened. It wasn't your fault. My mom always tries to reassure me of this, but I did feel like it was my fault. I was and still am ashamed of what happened. At about 9 years old, you really don't know what's going on. You know it's not right, but what are you supposed to do? I was young and scared. Eventually, I was exposed and so was he. I was the granddaughter to a child molester who raped me repeatedly for a 3-year time period. He would buy me things, take me on trips, and give me money. I believe that was his way to keep me from saying anything. By the time everyone had found out, he had promised that he wasn't gonna touch me anymore. I didn't believe him, but it had stopped. He had seen that I was getting more scared each and every time. I never opened my eyes when he would touch me, not once. I left my body lifeless and let him do whatever he wanted. It was the lowest point of my life. My brothers found out, but once I realized they knew, I had them promise me they wouldn't tell. However, the situation progressed, and unable to hold it in any longer, my brother Angel texted my mom. On an otherwise forgettable morning, I was called to the nurse's office where I found my mom sobbing uncontrollably. When I saw her, I just broke, shattered into pieces. I couldn't deny or hide the truth any longer. She blamed herself, which was the last thing I ever wanted. I never wanted anyone to know. In my childish innocence, I didn't want my family to hurt the way I did. I thought I was protecting them. The last time I ever had to face him was filled with mixed feelings. I was only allowed in the courtroom when it was my turn. The court didn't want me to hear what everyone else was saying. When it was my turn, I spent about 4 hours testifying. So did my mom, brother, and doctors I had seen as soon as the secret was out. My grandma, dad, and three aunts were there to support me. I was so scared of speaking in front of everyone, from family members that have never heard all the details, to complete strangers, the jury, the reporters. The story came out on NewJersey.com with my anonymous comments because I was a minor, giving the most intimate details. Everything he forced me to do, everything he did, all the places he did it, the four apartments, his truck, the restaurant he owned, anywhere he could touch me, he did. The secret was no longer, and everyone knew everything. It was hard not to make any eye contact. His wife and daughter had taken his side. I have so much hate for the both of them for thinking I'm lying. Why would I lie about this? It is impossible for me not to wonder why they were never there in the first place, especially my so-called grandmother. She was never home when it was happening. Maybe if she would have been around like she was supposed to, it would have never happened in the first place. My older brother testified against me after all that we've been through, him being one of the first two people I told. I am his sister, and he chose them. He was dead to me. The emptiness that I had suffered for so long was only made worse by the additional betrayals, and I doubted my worth. The pain was now shared and affected everyone, but it was now more excruciating. I couldn't help but blame myself for my family suffering due to the secret being exposed. I hear my mom's reassuring voice and now think, if I could take back time, I would have said something sooner, but I didn't always think like that. It has taken about 3 years of therapy to help me change my mind. I used to say I wish it was still a secret so I wouldn't have to deal with the problem and the 6+ years of continuous struggle. However, no matter what the jury decided, I was free of my secret, nothing more to hide. I was to never see him or his family again. A restraining order was placed from the very beginning, but he was convicted and given 26 years. I got my justice, I finally feel safe, and I'm glad to say I'm moving on.
Thank you, Natasha. Next reading is Jacob Fora with I'm Still Here.
I am not gay. I remember. I remember every day of the third, fourth, and fifth grade as me screaming at the top of my lungs, I am not gay. I didn't have a problem with gay people, but I hated being called something that wasn't me. My classmates told me I'm gay, ugly, and stupid. Even my so-called friends told me how much I look like a girl. I'll admit, I had long brown hair with blonde highlights that came out during bright days. I was born with high cheekbones, long eyelashes, and high arched eyebrows, but I wasn't gay. Their words felt like cymbals crashed against my head, like my classmates wanted to crack my head open and have the answers spill out. I didn't tell my mom because I knew she would go to the school and the other kids would think I'm a snitch and inflict more damage on me. My family really didn't help because they were always busy. My oldest brother was in and out of jail, while my other brother worked day and night and slept like a dead person. My mother had her own stuff going on that started when my stepfather came into her life. He took her on dates and parties in the city. The only time she was with me is when she cooked dinner or took me to the doctors. She was so starstruck in her relationship that she sometimes forgot about appointments, laundry, dinner, and so on. I felt like it was me against the world. I was stuck in a cold, dark abyss. As the bullying grew and the lack of attention from my family increased, I became a loner. Thoughts of suicide came across my mind. Every day I thought ending my life would be the answer. To cut the string from the knot, to end the shit that I was tangled in. I lived on the 6th floor. Jumping would be quick and painless. I looked at the high dosage prescription medication in the cabin and thought, how would they do the job? I woke up one day and realized if I killed myself, how my family would feel. My older brothers and cousin had a rough start in life. I represented a new awakening for them. They wanted me to be the change of our family. My Uncle David pushed me to be a successful person. If I got an A on my report card, he would want me to get an A+. Even though I felt like I was alone, I knew my family was there. I eventually went to live with my grandmother. My mother was heartbroken, but I knew it was the best situation for me. My grandmother took me in with open arms and made me go to church for her every Sunday. She taught me how to cook, clean, and take care of a house. She made me into a real man. She told me that no matter how hard life got, I will make it through and things will get better. Things have gotten better. My classmates don't pick on me anymore. I even come to realize those who picked on me actually deserve recognition because thanks to them, I am a stronger individual. My mom left my stepfather, and me and her relationship built ever since then. Nobody alive could take my mother's place. And the best part is, I'm still here.
Thank you, Jacob. And now, a performance by Willie Allen, accompanied by Arturo Lorenzo, singing Cherry Wine by Hozier.
The blood is red and sweet as
Thank you, Willie and Arturo. Next reading, untitled, Julio Lopez.
Okay, before I start, let me just say this. I haven't been on stage since third grade, so if I mess up, you'll know why. I don't know how to start this story off. It's a rather complicated thing to explain since it's been so recent. Let me start off with the source of my conundrum, why it's taken me so long to realize. When I was in middle school, around fifth or sixth grade, usually around the time when kids begin to hit puberty, I watched as many of the boys began to ask girls out, whistle at them, and all that stuff. I had social anxiety since third grade and felt like an outcast. From middle school to high school, it was the same old thing, same old badgering. Who do you like? Would you ever date so-and-so? Are you sure you're not gay? I always kept my calm and answered the same way. I don't like anyone at all. Trying to reassure me that not all was hopeless, the phrase often repeated to me was, you'll find someone out there. There's plenty of fish in the sea. In 11th grade, by the end of the second marking period, I had to move again to a completely new area, Hoboken. By then, I embraced something that had been in my head since 7th grade. I was asexual. I mean, it made sense since I wasn't interested in dating boys or girls. As crazy as it sounds, I'd embrace asexuality without opening up to anyone. In February, I began to post hints about my newfound asexuality. I wasn't sure if people were going to notice. I posted it on my personal account and one on the Facebook page I administer. Not many people noticed on my personal account, but on Facebook, it was a different story. Some people felt bad for me. Some told me I was missing out, while others said, you're cool anyways. On March 4th, I finally confessed to my family. My younger sisters didn't care much since they didn't know what it was. I don't blame them either. My brother didn't care much since it was pretty obvious. My mother didn't know what asexuality was, so I had to explain it to her. Then a couple weeks later in April, I felt different. I found myself conflicted. In the back of my head, three annoying voices, consciences, kept saying, you're lying to yourself. You know that, right? You aren't asexual. You're just really shy, dude. And you're young and haven't done much, so don't jump to conclusions, okay? The voices were right. I was too shy to interact with people. I pushed everyone away and thought it would work by calling myself asexual. Then I asked them, what the hell am I? You three are supposed to guide me. Please, tell me what am I? Suddenly it came to me. You're you, and that should be good enough. Sure, you want to try to avoid everyone else in the world around you. But really, all you want is someone who will be there for you, who isn't too judgmental, and doesn't care if you're too quiet. The answer was inside, the voice I needed to listen to. Since then, I feel a bit more confident. I'm still quiet, but I'm working on fixing that. If anyone asked me now what I'm into, my answer would be, I don't know what I like, but it doesn't matter as long as I'm happy being me. As of today, am I asexual? No longer debating it. Am I gay? No. Am I heterosexual? Looks like it. Am I bisexual? No. Am I demisexual? Yes, I am. What do I really want? Someone to help me. What do I really want? Someone to help me forget that I'm super shy about everything, but makes me laugh and smile anyway. I am untitled.
Thank you, Julio. Our next reader is Dejon Van Ness, reading Pop Pop.
my papa. I'm going to try my hardest to dig deep in my thoughts and scenarios in my mind to paint a perfect picture of him. He was a very smart man, very. I have also heard so many stories about him, good, funny, and courageous stories. I've been told how in several situations my papa could have lost his life because of what he said at gunpoint, but the other men thought twice. I haven't heard a story criticize him yet. Even at his worst, he was a funny and strong man. Why? Because a man has to do what a man has to do. Respect was a law, not a decision. Papa was my mother's father. My mother is a funny person. She is wise and cool. She dresses amazing and was a very close person to him. Throughout history, the only thing that was able to separate them was his rest date. My mother speaks of him 24/7. He held all aspects of a family down and never gave up till his spirit departed. He did everything in his power to make his family happy. Why? Because if they were happy, he was happy. My last memory I have of him was when we were leaving out our apartment on Storms Avenue in Jersey City. We were in the parking lot. He drove a black Cadillac with chrome piped rims and a burgundy interior. Inside and out, he had that car shining. No one could look at it only once. The shine drew people's attention to it. The seats were all leather and always smelled of armor oil, the leather seats wipes he used. Every sharp turn he took caused me to slide to the other side of the seat, even when the seat belt was wrapped around me tight. There were times when the seat belt would lock and constrain me. I'd get frustrated and even teary-eyed. He turned around and say, "Oh boy, hush up, it's like this, come here." And he will always be the only one to get the seatbelt loose. I remember my grandmother was in the passenger seat. He was in the driver's seat. I reached forward and hugged them both. I looked at him and then out the windshield, and that's where my memory stops. He often just came and picked me up and spent the most time he could with me. I enjoyed every bit of it. He was the coolest, smoothest, and most heartfelt person, if he was on his good side. From the park swings, smiles, to frowns, car rides, to stores, he treated me special, and I still feel special even after his passing. Thanks to him, I have big feet, hands, heart, and a frame of mind. Like him, I am an old soul. Sometimes I wonder why is that I can listen to old music with no problem, drink black coffee like it was water. I realize it because of my papa. In the future, I want to make him proud and to follow his footsteps. On July 13th, 2002, it ended. He died suddenly of an aneurysm. My mother was at the house with him. At the funeral, there was no one who didn't cry. The saddest thing for me was not to see his face every day. I know he's gone, but the wisdom he left is in my soul. I know you're watching, Pops. I love your legacy and your title. Trust me, no one can replace you. No one can fill your shoes. No one can hold the meaning of your name high like you did. He called me Peanut and Partner. People called him the Jack of all trades, and I called him Papa.
Thank you, DeJean. Our next author reading, Brothers, Jazian Gamma.
As a child, my brother was a normal baby boy. He played, laughed, cried, and did everything that a baby can do. He was so happy even though I was yet to be born. My mom has always said he was the happiest child on earth. Nothing could have changed that smile he had on his face. His laugh could have brightened up anyone's day. At 1 year old, he was walking and running. My mother told me the story of what happened to my brother when he was very young. We had a leak in the bathroom, so my parents put a bucket under to catch the water. The bucket got halfway full, and my brother was walking around the house playing with his toys. He used to love playing with his toys. He made his way into the bathroom, and one of his toys fell into the bucket. My brother reached into the bucket to get his toy. A period of time passed, and my mom became worried. She searched the house for my brother. She found him in the bathroom. It was my mother's worst nightmare. He was in the bucket of water, nearly dead, fighting for air. No mother should have gone through the shock and horror my mother went through in that moment. She held her son half dead in her arms. She ran out the house holding my brother and screaming. My family waited in the hospital for the news about my brother to see if he would pull through. Later that day, the doctor came out and told my mother that he would be brain damaged for the rest of his life. Just hearing that broke my mother's heart. Even though he was saved, he would never talk again, walk again. My brother couldn't do anything. He was just a baby. He would have grew up in that state. Someone had to come to help my brother and take care of him. On December 27th, everything in my life changed. Everything in my and my whole family's lives changed. I woke up to the voice of my older brother's nurse in our room. She called to my brother, "Nanette, wake up. Nanette, wake up. Wake up." He didn't respond. She went to my mother's room to tell her that her son wasn't waking up. My mother ran into our room. She knew from the sight that her son wasn't here no more. I never heard my own mother cry like that, the way she did. I can feel the agony and the pain in her screams. I was traumatized. I couldn't even sleep in my own room for months because of the thought of my brother had passed away right next to me where I slept. Yeah, it had such an effect on me. I couldn't believe that my own brother wasn't here no more. No matter how much I begged, there was nothing I could do to bring him back. Nothing worked for me. I just couldn't believe that my brother wasn't here no more. After months, I gained enough strength to be able to step foot in my own room. I felt like someone was watching me every second of the day. My room was so cold, I could feel it in my bones as if I was out on a cold night. Nothing in my room was the same anymore. Nothing in my life was the same anymore. I had to recover from what I saw that day, and I had to recover from what I've been through. I had to accept the fact that my big brother had passed away, but deep down, I was hurt. But I knew that my big brother, Nene, was at peace.
Thank you, Jazian. Our next author reading, My Abuelo, Jocelyn Rodriguez.
If there were phones in heaven, I would need your number. I would need your number to hear your voice.
Take your time.
Lord. Oh my God, the fix in this tissue is burning my eye. Okay. To hear your voice, to listen to you sing those sweet melodies in my ear, to simply know you are a redial away from my fingertips. To keep your memory alive in my heart. My Uncle Nino tells me he is going inside to see my abuelo. It is okay. Is it okay that I walk in with you? I ask. He says yes, but checks several times if I am positive that I want to go in with him. I can hear the sadness in his voice, and I understand his pain. As we all are hurting in the same way. He grabs my hand and holds it tight as we start to walk down the aisle. He hooks his arm under mine, supporting me, holding me up. I feel him look down at me. But I am thinking about my abuelo. In Spanish, grandfather is abuelo. In Spanish, grandfather is abuelo, but I called him abuelo for short. I think back to when I was 5 years old. I walked into my Uncle Saul's kitchen and saw my abuelo sitting in the chair at his table. I climbed into his lap and reached for his birthmark. I couldn't resist touching his birthmark on his forehead. I knew he was getting ready to say his magic word. I was excited and I giggled. I pressed his birthmark and beep his magic word. I pressed it over and over again and beep, beep. I remember how just a couple of weeks ago I had visited him in the hospital. I sang Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. The song I learned for our holiday show in school. I was so happy. I knew all of the words, and I was excited. I was so happy I knew all of the words, and I was excited to sing to one of the few people I always wanted to make proud. I wanted to make him feel better since he had been sitting in the hospital bed for a while. I loved to put a smile on his face. He was one of my favorite people in the whole entire world. When we were halfway down the aisle, I caught a glimpse of my grandfather. And I go down, I see my uncle reach for my arm, but I collapse in the middle of the aisle. I am on the floor crying. I watch everything around me disappear. It hits me that my abuelo is gone, that I will never see, hear, feel, or speak to him again. When I find the strength to say goodbye, I walk to the casket and touch his hand. He is cold. I give him a kiss on the forehead, lay my hand on his cheek, and walk away. My Willow passed away April 22nd, 2007. I cried for days afterward. I know he is in a better place, but I wish he were here with me. Missing someone isn't really about how long it's been since you've last seen them, or the moment, or the amount of time since you talked, but it's about the moment that you are doing something and you wish they were right there with you. I miss you, Willow. I love you.
Thank you, Jocelyn. The next reader is Nashalia Rivera, reading My Best Mistake.
Hi. Okay. My best mistake. In life, you have one man who is supposed to always love, care, and protect you, no matter what the circumstances. That one man is your father. He is there to show you how to be a smart, strong, brave woman, to guide you and teach you how a man is supposed to treat you. One of the most important things he should make sure you understand is never let a man put his hands on you for any reason. That there is no excuse for physical, mental, or even spiritual harm. In my case, with my father living in Puerto Rico, I really only have my mother as a mother slash father figure. My aunt and godmother have also reminded me of good and bad things in life, but sometimes it's not until you experience it that you really understand. It took me 2 years to realize the meaning behind my family saying, God gives you a choice to walk away, and if you choose to stay, he allows that person to hurt you until you realize it's too late. It was around November when the traumatizing experiences started happening and changing my life in a negative way. I was in a relationship under the category of abusive, which for my age should have never existed, but it did. He was older than me and bigger, of course, because I am tiny. Like every other relationship, it all started off as roses and rainbows, but some people just can't control their jealousy and anger, so it leads to something else. I mean, what can a girl do if she's liked by a lot of boys and has a lot of guy friends? At first, the comments started with, don't talk to him or be near him. Then it progressed to more serious things, such as not being able to wear certain clothes, not being able to hang out with friends, not being able to play gym with certain people, and even being threatened to not go to the park with my own family. I always felt like I was in too deep. I felt like I had no way to get out of the situation, even when I now know I had every right and all the power. For example, there's this quote, when you give something power, it has power over you. And I honestly felt like that was just my life in a sentence. There were times when I felt like just ending my life. I spent time wishing it would be taken from me, thinking that maybe that was the only way out. My eyes are blurry, hold up. However, what motivated me not to was the thought of my family having to bear that loss. I never told anyone because I never knew how to. It's actually very hard to say how you're feeling when you feel so terrible. I guess I was afraid of the outcome and what might follow if I spoke up, even though I didn't know what that might be. I hate myself for it, and I know I'm hated for allowing it to happen. If I could go back in time, I would change everything. Wouldn't we all go back and change our past? But in a way, it's a lesson learned. It made me stronger and less tolerant to many things, including disrespect. They were the worst 2 wasted years of my life. If I had just listened to an old friend of mine and my sister when they warned me about it, it might not have happened. They could see the first signs of it getting worse, but no, I just let it slide and got stuck on the ride. My past haunts me so much.
is basically what I think about every day of my life, including the nights. They are the worst, and I often end up crying myself to sleep. Then I bottle up those emotions and feelings, just like the rest of them. People tell me that bottling up is no good, but I can't help keeping it to myself. People ask me why I'm so happy all the time. I just stare at them and smile, because it's an illusion that disguises my inner emotions. It makes life easier. I have so much anger that sometimes I'm scared of someone pushing me to the point where I explode. I can see myself taking it all out on them without meaning to. People swear they know your life and your story, but in reality, they know nothing. This experience was a terrible one, but in a sense, it has been one of my best mistakes. I am now a stronger person.
Thank you, Nashley. Our next author reading, Where I Am, Diana Paredes.
Well, I have something to say. Like, there are sad stories. There are exciting stories. Mine is that. I promise you guys won't shed a tear. Right. My whole life, I've wanted to explore the world and have new experiences that I could share. Adventures that would lead me to the unknown future, some expected places. Here, to one special adventure. Music has always been a big part of my life. I fell in love with the idea of live music, concerts. I knew that going to a concert would be a fun experience, but I never thought that it would impact me as much as it did. On the morning of July 2nd, anxiety ran through my bloodstream. My favorite band was in town, and I wanted to go see them perform live. The only issue was I didn't have tickets. I remember my mom saying, Diana, we could go check the tickets out at the arena. They might still have them at the booths. I nodded my head in agreement. She knew how much I wanted to see them live. As we headed there, I hoped there were tickets left. At the booth, the ticket lady said, I'm sorry, sweetie, the tickets are all sold out. You can check the site later on to see if they release any leftover tickets before the show. Back home, I kept looking at my old clock that hung on my bedroom wall. All I could think about was 7 p.m., the time the show began. I paced back and forth in my room. I remember my brother saying, Diana, stop pacing, you're gonna create a draft. But keeping calm was impossible. Worry clouded my thoughts. It was 6 p.m. I went on the site one last time, and as if in a fairy tale movie, tickets were magically on sale. I was shocked. I begged my mom to buy them. She hesitated, but I insisted it would be an early birthday present. And so it all began. When I got to the stadium, I could see the thousands of girls lining up, scanning the tickets, face paint, tour shirts, merchandise stands. It was all there, even the overpriced water. I was amazed. It was like a rush of adrenaline. I was thrilled at the idea of being independent and having fun alongside other people I didn't know, but shared something in common with. It's crazy how people can come together and share a love for a person who does their job every night on a stage, and to watch the passion with which they do it. As I walked onto the floor, I could see all the girls looking for their seats and getting ready for the show to begin. I was excited even though I was alone. Many of my friends don't like the same music I do. Some are too busy, and others just make up excuses for not wanting to experience new things. And so there I was, alone in the crowd, level 2, in row 1, seat 12. Red, blue, yellow, pink, and purple spotlights bounced off all the girls' heads, highlighting the huge crowd. There was a sea of people gathered together in a single spot. I looked at all the signs and posters that were spread around the stadium. Free, that's what I felt. Invincible. I forgot about all my problems, all my issues, and for 2 hours enjoyed the best night of my life. That night, I listened as my favorite band sang. Just listening with my eyes closed, it soothed me like a rocking chair would soothe a baby. The lyrics to the songs weren't just words. They had meaning. They told a story that I could relate to. People might think you can connect with the song just by listening to it, but in reality, it's different standing there and feeling the music pouring through my veins, the lyrics sinking through the deepest part of my mind. Home isn't always an address. Those packed stadiums with thousands of girls and confetti, overpriced water, and posters with catchy puns, they're a part of me. Concerts made me outgoing, crazy, and funny. They showed me that living in the moment was the best thing to do, to be myself and live life as if it were my last 2 hours. I learned that being independent isn't something I should fear, but something I should face. Being alone gave me that space to think, and then not to think at all, to be free and let my mind wander. Everyone is different. I guess for me, it was a concert that allowed me to break out of that barrier I had around me and begin to live.
Our next reader is Crystal Ortiz, reading My Brother's Keeper.
The door crept open. My mother and father walked in with my little brother at last. Seeing Stephen's face reassured me that he was going to be okay, but I had mixed emotions. For the past few months, I tried to forget him, to accept the fact that he might not come home. But there he was, alive in our flesh, in our living room. A big welcoming smile came upon my face. He was pale. He dragged his feet and body across the room. He couldn't fully pick up his feet as he walked. He hardly spoke, barely moved a finger. His lips were so chapped, they looked ready to bleed. I was glad to be reunited with him, but I felt bad. I wanted to help him. I wanted to cure him and make him feel normal again. My brother was sick. He caught a rare disease called Kawasaki disease that only occurs in children. It is hard to tell how Stephen was exposed to the sickness. He was just a little kid, only 6 years old. It was serious. It caused inflammation in the cell blood vessels, harming arteries that carry blood to the heart muscles. He had been diagnosed 2 months earlier and had to spend all that time in St. Jude's Hospital fighting for his life. The symptoms were hard to watch. It gave him high fevers, rashes all over his body. He had red bloodshot eyes, swollen cracked lips. He got strawberry tongue where shiny, bright red spots coated his mouth, and swollen red sores appeared on his hands, feet, palms, and soles of his feet. He was seen by numerous specialists and given all kinds of treatments. He was pricked with needles as different tests were run. He was very ill from the disease, and I was the worst sister ever. The entire period he was in the hospital, I didn't visit him not once. The doctor said he might not make it. It was hard hearing the news, but I prepared myself. He was going to die. It was wrong, but I forced myself. The actor John Travolta's son lost his life a couple days before my brother was diagnosed with the same disease. I figured if John Travolta's son, who was older and definitely stronger than my brother, didn't survive, then surely my six-year-old little brother wouldn't either. I refused to visit him. I didn't want to feel the same pain I felt when I found out I lost an older brother. My older brother died when he was a baby in his sleep. Nobody knew why it happened. Although I never met him, I wonder so much about him. How life would have been different. It happened again. My little brother got sick and no one knew why. My mother struggled through the death of my first older brother. I didn't want her to go through it twice. I couldn't bear losing him. I turned off my emotions and I went numb towards the situation. That is until he came through that door. I knew he didn't feel well enough for me to squeeze him and smother him with love, so instead I gave him a big hug and kiss and said, "Welcome home, baby bro." I spent the whole day lying on the couch with him. I let him pick out the shows for us to watch and the food for us to eat. The stuff we usually argued about, I let go. We talked, laughed, and goofed around all day through the night. We lost track of time and fell sound asleep holding each other arm in arm. I will never take my little brother for granted again. I would cherish every moment and protect him with my life. I am my brother's keeper, and I count every day I spend with him as a new blessing.
Thank you, Crystal. Our next reader is Linda Rosado, with her story of Heaven Couldn't Wait.
It was June and I was 9 years old. I was in the fourth grade and an honor roll student. I was one of the handful of lucky students chosen to go to the beach for a field trip. I remember having an exciting feeling in my stomach, but when I arrived home from my sister's house in Jersey City, that excitement ended. The scene came out of nowhere, or at least that's how I remember it. I walked in and found my father lying on his bed with tubes in his nose. I was confused. 2 days ago, he was perfectly fine, walking around, moving, laughing, talking. My mother pulled me from the room and sat me on the chair. He won't live much longer, Linda. He has brain cancer. She said in an apologetic tone. I sat there in disbelief and for a quick moment saw the worry in her big brown eyes. She seemed like she was about to cry, but quickly got up and walked away. I didn't want to believe my ears. I didn't want him to die. I didn't even know that he was sick. He was so young. He was a great father, and I needed him. I needed him to help me through the things in the future. I sat in the chair for at least 5 minutes. I walked over to a picture of him carrying me as a baby. I started to weep. I didn't want him to leave me. I wanted him to watch me graduate middle school and take a picture with me before I went off to prom and walk me down the aisle on my wedding day. And the following days were spent with my dad, even though he couldn't do much. I went to school that Monday. I remember going straight to his room with my nephew, Justin, who was only 11 months younger than I am, when I got home. At 4:30 p.m., my nephew left, and I was alone with my father. I pulled a chair close to his bed and held his hand. I love you, I said. I could tell that he desperately wanted to say it back. His lips moved, but nothing came out. A tear fell from his eye. I couldn't tell if it was from sadness or joy, so I smiled, kissed him on the forehead, and wiped away his tear. 20 minutes later, my mom walked into the room crying. Did you see your father? Yes, I told her. I knew something was wrong, but I didn't want to know it. I wanted to get lost in my book and pretended that my father wasn't dying. But a little while later, when I left my room, I found my whole family crying. My nephew burst through the living room and ran as fast as he could into my father's room. Tears ran down his cheek. I knew my father was gone, but I didn't want to believe it. I wanted him to hold me in his arms and tell me that everything would be all right. I walked into his room and saw him. He was pale. Light from the sun came into the window and shined directly on him. It wasn't shining on him when he was alive. His eyes were still open, but they weren't the beautiful green eyes they used to be. Instead, they were deep dark brown. I remember running from the room. I cried my eyes out. My cousin held me in her delicate warm arms and started to cry with me as I hugged her back. I hated crying in front of people, but this was the appropriate time to cry. You still want to go to school tomorrow and go on that field trip or go to the funeral home? My mother asked. Sometimes people try to prevent their loved ones from getting hurt, and I think my mother was trying to do that for me. The funeral home, I replied. My father was more important than that trip. I didn't care anymore if I was one of the lucky ones. My father was buried that Friday at the cemetery. As they lowered him into the ground, I realized I was the last person he saw. The last thing he tried to say to me was, I love you too. I wasn't prepared to lose my father at the age of 9, but now that I remember, now when I think about it, none of my family was prepared for the loss. I don't think anybody could be prepared for loss, because prepared or not, you still hurt. I'm 16 and still think about my father every day.
Thank you, Linda. Our next author reading, My Grandpa, Elisa Soler.
My grandmother passed away before my mother knew she was pregnant with me, leaving me only my grandfather on her side of the family. My grandfather looked after me. When we visited, I'd always played with him. I loved to wear his sandals and fall asleep on him. Even today, hot summer days fill me with nostalgia, bringing me back memories of how I used to jump on his bed. I remember how my mom would yell at me to get down, and he would yell at her for yelling at me. He knew I was a child in my own world, having fun. I was only 3 at the time, but still managed to remember so much. Then he got sick. I remember he was in the room lying down, and nurses came to the house to watch and care for him. My aunt and I were in the kitchen playing with Play-Doh. Suddenly, paramedics rushed into the house. My mom told my aunt to keep me in the kitchen and to not let me go in his room. I knew that wasn't gonna happen. I was curious and I wanted to know what was happening. When my aunt wasn't looking, I got off the chair and ran to his room and looked in. Wires and tubes were connected to my grandpa. I was confused and I yelled, "Mommy." The paramedics looked back and urged my mom to get me out the room. She picked me up and yelled at me for not listening. My aunt sat me in the kitchen table and fixed my hair. She looked at me and said, "Don't worry, baby. Everything's gonna be all right. Grandpa's just sick." That wasn't enough. I wanted to go see my grandpa. I wanted to touch him. I told my aunt that I needed to use the bathroom. I wanted to pass by the room again. She looked at me with a serious face. "Don't go in the room, Elisa. I'm serious. They're going to yell at you." I went in the bathroom, opened the door, made it seem like I went inside, and sneaked out. His door was closed halfway. I could see through the crack. The paramedics were rushing around while my mom was standing next to my grandfather, covering her face. He looked awful. The nurse injected him with something, and my grandpa looked up at my mom and reached out, his hand trying to speak. Suddenly, his hand dropped, and my mom yelled. Everything started to slow down. I heard a strange beep in the background as he used the defibrillator to bring him back. It wasn't working. Just then, my aunt swept me off my feet and back to the kitchen, and then take her eyes off me. It was the last day my grandpa was alive. I didn't really know what I witnessed until I looked back on it as I got older. My mom was emotionally distressed, but I never understood how much his death affected her at the time. I believe my grandpa has been with me through my years as my guardian angel and will continue to protect me over my times to come.
Thank you, Elisa. Our next reader is Victoria Perez with Forgiveness.
It was March 27th. I dreaded the day since the moment I received the fancy envelope in the mail back in December. I didn't exactly have to go, but I knew for my sake that I needed to. I knew my life would change forever. It was the day that I have to confront my father in court. It had been almost 2 years since I had last seen him. I forgot what he looked like and what his voice sounded like, but most of all, I forgot what it felt like to actually see him. I was overcome with emotions. I waited patiently for the judge to gather my case information, for my father to enter the courtroom in the cuffs and the blue jumpsuit as seen on the inmates brought in before him. I wasn't ready for what I was about to see and feel. The police officers brought in my father. I looked straight into his eyes, even though I know he wasn't allowed to look in mine. I felt a type of pain I never felt before. My heart began to hurt and I started to sob. There was a lady appointed to me by the court that was supposed to walk me through how the procedure of sentencing would go, sitting right next to me. She tried to console me by telling me that after this day, I'd never have to see him again. His words only made me feel worse. I didn't want my father to go away. As bad as he hurt me, the pain of knowing I wouldn't have contact with him again hurt worse. My father wasn't perfect. He had a share of mistakes, had a difficult time showing love, but he was still my father and I loved him. The judge asked him, "What do you plead?" The word guilty broke my heart. If I was still angry about what had happened, then I probably wouldn't have cared, but somewhere in my heart I found a spot for forgiveness. The judge asked if he had anything he wanted to say. He was so overcome with remorse that he couldn't do anything but cry. I covered my eyes and whispered to myself, "This isn't happening. This isn't happening." My heart began to ache and my eyes began to water as I ran my face into my boyfriend Amelson's chest. I heard the prosecutor tell the judge that I had a few things to say. She was talking about a letter I wrote while I was angry. I wrote how bad he hurt me and how he failed to be there for me when I needed him. I didn't want to read the letter anymore. I knew he felt remorse, and that's all I needed to heal. I told her that I didn't want to read the letter, but she insisted, took it from my hand, and began to read. "Why'd you give up on me? I could have made something of myself and made you proud." I knew those words hurt him worse than the thought of jail time. I felt everyone in the courtroom stare at me, and I heard my father sobbing. I felt terrible. I told the judge that I had more to say. She let me proceed from where the prosecutor left off. I told my dad that no matter how bad his betrayal hurt, I'd forgive him, and that I loved him no less than I did before it happened. I told him that I'd always remember the great moments we had. I told him I was gonna have a daughter, but I wouldn't tell her why she couldn't see him. I promised to make sure that my daughter knew that he was the man who wiped the tears from my face when I fell down and cried. I knew my words hit him right in the heart. I didn't get to say it all. I wish I told him not to beat himself up for what happened. I wish I wished him luck while he was in jail for those 4 years. I wish I told him what when they deport him back to the Dominican Republic and he needs help, then I take the trip to help him. Many people think I'm crazy for wanting to see my dad again, but I don't think so. I think people miss the big picture. It's about forgiveness and believing someone can change, because that really matters.
Good job, Victoria. And now, a video created by William Ethier III, Jacob Fora, and Matthew Vasquez.
All you do is sit at a typewriter and bleed.
Even these ways of Hemingway.
At our keyboards.
Before a blank screen.
Expecting to hemorrhage some profound truth.
But nothing came.
We were vastly disappointed.
We're frustrated at our inability
to write a single word or phrase.
We heard the clock ticking.
All our phones vibrated.
We were done.
But we were not done.
Yeah. Reading the staccato rhythm of Hemingway.
The cool rain kept on.
And killed the spring.
Read the harsh tone.
The Hawthorne's prose.
What other dungeon is so dark?
One's own heart.
We pondered the mood.
Of terror painted by Poe.
Falling, it was rain.
But having falling, it was blood.
Like Thoreau, we found that.
The roses have thorns about them.
We were in the throes of discovering how great authors skillfully draw blood and the reader into their world.
Writing is not opening a wound, the blood gushing and splattering randomly.
There is something more to it. Rather, writing is a bloodletting.
A slow, visceral dripping.
It is a careful crafting of words.
Our readers aim to reveal an oddity of simple truths.
With new understanding, we say and wrote our truth.
The carefully chosen words we've led on these pages.
Or simple truth is what you will discover
through our stories.
Truth which we have discovered
about ourselves and the world around us.
Here we have opened our veins and skillfully let the droplets of blood flow from our hearts.
We are.
We are.
We are.
It's been a long day without you, my friend. And I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. When I see you again.
Damn. All the planes we flew, good things we've been through, then I'll be standing right here talking to you about another path. I know we love to hit the road and laugh, but something told me that it wouldn't last. Had to switch up, look at things different, see the bigger picture. Those were the days, hard work forever pays. Now I see you in a better place. See you in a better place. How can we not talk about family when family's all that we got? Everything I went through, you were standing there by my side. And now you gon' be with me for the last ride.
It's been a long day without you, my friend. And I'll tell you all about it when I see you again.
See you again.
We've come a long way.
Came a long way.
From where we began.
You know we started.
Oh, I'll tell you.
See you again.
When I see you again.
Oh. feeling stronger. What's small turn to a friendship, a friendship turn to a bond, and that bond will never be broken. The love will never get lost. And when brotherhood come first, then the line will never be crossed. Established it on our own when that line had to be drawn, and that line is what we reach. So remember me when I'm gone. Talk about family, with family's all that we got. Everything I went through, you were standing there by my side. And now you gon' be with me for the last. So let the light.
Juniors.
Stop being ghetto.
Wow, okay. We would like to thank our teachers, Mr. Barfield, Ms. Hack, Mr. Huggins. Miss Kelly and Mrs. Stevens for their tireless support and inspiration. Mr. Barfield, Miss Hack, Mr. Huggins, Miss Kelly, and Mrs. Stevens, please come to the stage.
I'm gonna give the most special one to Ms. Hack.
Chef Nelson for their contribution to our celebration. The Hoboken School Administration and Board of Education, Christina Romeo, and the SPI team.
Oh, but she burns like rum on a fire, hot and fast and angry as can be. I walk my days on a wire. It looks ugly, but it's so clean. Oh, mama, don't fuss over me. The way she shows me I'm hers and she's mine. Open hand or closed fist would be fine. The blood as rare and sweet as cherry wine. Calls of guilty thrown at me all while she stains the sheets of some other. So powerfully, just like she throws with the arms of her brother. What I wanted, it's a crime that she's not around most of.